Hello friends, myself Dr. Devesh Mishra, and today I am going to tell you a very important topic in pathology, that is cytopathology. And this lecture will be only basic introduction, diseases and their interpretation via cytopathology I will be discussing in another video. So let's start. So what is the meaning of cytopathology? It's a branch of pathology where you are going to study only about the cells. So study about these cells is called as cytopathology. You are seeing only cells. You are not seeing their relation with the blood vessel or to the surrounding tissue or to the capsule, right? So you are just seeing cells on the slide like this. That's all. You are not going to see any kind of relation with the surrounding tissue or structure. That is why it is called as cytopathology, right? So this cytopathology branch was founded by one of the scientists. His name was Georges Nicolas Papanicolaou in 1928, right? So Georges Nicolas Papanicolaou has discovered this cytology, branch or cytopathology branch, which has three branches. So cytopathology is having three branches. One is called exfoliative cytology. Second is interventional cytology, and third is imprint cytology. I'm going to discuss them, in detail after this, right? So I'm just giving you outline. There are three branches of the cytology: exfoliative cytology, interventional cytology, and imprint cytology. Interventional cytology has two sub-branches, that is the fine needle aspiration cytology, FNAC, and sediment cytology, right? So one by one, I'm going to tell you. First, in exfoliative cytology, what is the use of this exfoliative and what we actually look for? What is utilized in the exfoliative cytology? In exfoliative cytology, we are studying about the cells which has been shed down from the surface into the body cavity or into the body fluid, right? So study of shed down cells. Remember, these are the shed down cells which are used in the exfoliative cytology. So these are the shed down cells either into the body fluid or into the body cavities, right? Now in exfoliative cytology also there are two categories. One is the spontaneous exfoliation and second is the mechanical exfoliation. Spontaneous exfoliation means cells are spontaneously shedding from the surface, right? So see this, spontaneous means there is no effort. We are not keeping any external effort to take out the cell. They are automatically, they are shedding down from the surface and they're coming into the fluid. So where it can be possible? It can be possible in the pleural, like lung cavity, pleural fluid, or into the peritoneal fluid, right? So they are spontaneously shedding from the surface and coming into the pleural fluid or peritoneal fluid. That is spontaneous exfoliation, right? Second type is the mechanical exfoliation. Mechanical exfoliation, you are seeing the cells scrapped from the surface, right? Now here you can see you are using the external force. Now you are using the brush or scraping brush to scrape the cells from the surface, right? Which we usually use in the bronchial brushing or in the pap smear when you are doing the cervical scraping, or even for the oral cancer, oral scraping is done, right? So now you understand, mechanical exfoliation, cells are scraped from the surface with the help of brushes, right? So when it is spontaneous, when they are coming out with the help of the brushes, then it is called as mechanical exfoliation, right? So these are the two types of exfoliative cytology. So exfoliative cytology, there are two main techniques which we are using. So try to understand. I am going to discuss this detail in the later section, means in another video, not here in this video, because it's the basic introduction, right? So conventional cytology, which we follow in FNAC. Second is the liquid based cytology. This one I am talking about. This I will make a separate video to explain you about the liquid based cytology, right? So exfoliative cytology, two main techniques are used. That is the conventional and liquid based cytology. Now coming to the second part, second branch is interventional. See, the name itself is very interventional. You have to intervention, right? So who are these things? Who have to intervention? These are the pathologist or clinician, right? So they have to intervention to take out the biopsy from the body, right? For example, suppose a patient has come with a lymph node, right? So we have to intervene. A pathologist or a surgeon is going to take out the biopsy from here or from the needle. He will be taking FNAC from the here. So that is why it is called as interventional cytology. Right. So pathologist or clinician is intervening body for the sample collection. That is called as interventional cytology. Interventional cytology has also, you know, two sub branches, FNAC, sediment cytology. Right. So FNAC means you are going to use the, you know, fine needle aspiration cytology. So you are going to have a needle which will be attached to the syringes. From there, you are going to collect the sample. So you are putting the needle and syringe into the lymph node and you are taking out the sample. That is called as FNAC. So what is the size of needle we are using in FNAC is 23 to 27 gauge needle, right? So remember, it is 23 to 27 gauge needle. Cells are aspirated. How cells are aspirated? See, as I said, needle and syringes are there. So you have to take out the plunger. So there will be a creation of the negative suction, and that is how it has been aspirated. So with this negative suction will pull the cell material into the needle hub. Right, into the needle or needle hub. So that is why we are calling cells are aspirated by negative suction. Right, second is the sediment cytology. What we do here, suppose a surgeon or operative person has taken out the tissue, right, and they have kept them into the formalin. So now biopsy is kept in the fixative. So now we are going to take out the fixative. See, biopsy has been kept inside the fixative. And we need to study about the cell. So what we are going to do, we are going to take out the fixative solution where biopsy was fixed, because there will be some cells which has been shut down from the biopsy into the fixative. So how we are going to deal this? We are going to keep this fixative into the centrifuge and we are going to perform the centrifugation of this fixative solution. So after fixative solution centrifugation, we are going to prepare cell sediment. That is why it is called as sediment cytology. So basic crux is to take out even a single abnormal cell from the fixative, which has been taken out from the biopsy specimen, right? So we are centrifuging and preparing the cell sediment, right? That is called as sediment cytology, right? So interventional cytology, FNAC by negative suction. Second is the sediment cytology. After the centrifugation of the fixative solution, we are creating the cell button or cell sediment, right? Now in imprint cytology, third branch, imprint cytology, you can see the name itself is telling. We are taking out the tissue. Suppose biopsy has been taken out. Now this biopsy tissue will be touching on the glass slide. Suppose this is the glass slide. So we are touching the glass slide with the biopsy specimen. And now cells are imprinted on this slide. So the cells are imprinted on this slide. That is why it is called as imprint cytology, right? So here we have to remember, there was a question in a state exam. Imprint cytology is most commonly used on which tissue? So remember, on the lymph node biopsy. For example, a surgeon has seen a lymph node while doing the gastric resection of the suspected malignancy. Right, suspected malignancy. So now he is suspecting that this lymph node could be the site of metastasis. So he will cut down the lymph node into two pieces. Now he will take out the open area and he will touch the lymph node to the slide. So this is called imprint cytology. So that cells are imprinted on the slide. Right. So, and most commonly tissue used for imprint cytology is the lymph node. That was the question in exam. Now coming to the this picture, you can see this is the picture where beautifully you can see imprint cytology. Now you can see this is the biopsy tissue, right? This is the biopsy tissue, and now you are seeing these are the already imprinted here, right? So these are all the imprint cytology, right? So these are all the imprint cells present on the slide, right? So this is the imprint cytology. You are seeing you are touching the tissue on the slide and then you are preparing the sample, right? That is called as imprint cytology, right? Now next we are going to see what are the requirement of the FNAC. So first of all, you should know that you have to take out the consent from the patient. Take out the written consent from the patient and explain the procedure to the patient in a well or in a proper manner or in a well explained manner. So that patient should be also aware and he should be also, prepared for all those outcomes, right? And then you require syringes and needle. Already I have told you needle size will be 22 to 27 gauge needle. It can be 23, 27 or 22 to 27 gauge, whatever. It's both are right, right? Pistol grip syringe holder. That is very, very important. Pistol grip syringe holder is also important. And there are two named syringe holders, Frenzels and Cameco syringe holder. Then this is the second thing. Second and third thing, you require slides so that you can put the specimen on the slide or cell on the slide, and then you have to keep them inside the jar, which is called as Coplin jar, right? And then finally you require fixative to fix the cytological specimen, right? So these are the four things. Now you understand. So these are the four important things we require: syringe and needles, pistol grip syringe holders, slide and Coplin jar, and fixatives, right? So see, this is the total requirement, basic requirement before you perform any cytological study, right? So here you can see there are Coplin jar, here you can see there is a Coplin jar, this is the lid, right? And inside the Coplin jar, I will show you in another picture, they will be having slots for the slides where you can keep the slide inside them. This is the cotton swab for cleaning the area with the spirit so that you can poke the needle and you can take out the sample. This one is the pistol handle, right? So this is the syringe pistol handle. You can see this is like a pistol, and in this you can notice there is a syringe and there is a needle, right? This is the forceps to keep this slide inside the Coplin jar, right? So now you can see this is the syringe holder looking like a gun, so that is why it is called as pistol grip syringe holder. So pistol grip syringe holder can be Cameco or Frenzel syringe holder. What they will do, see, they are holding the syringe and needle. So what is their basic purpose? Their basic purpose is to help the clinician or pathologist palpate the lesion from one hand. You can see one hand is used for fixation of the lesion and second hand is holding the pistol so that they can do the biopsy. So that is the basic advantage. One hand will be free for the mass location and one hand will be free for the doing the biopsy. So one hand is to palpate and fix the nodule, other hand is to place the needle and perform the biopsy using suction. So that is the use of this pistol grip syringe holder, right? One hand is free for fixation, one hand is free for biopsy, right? Now after taking out the biopsy, you will be preparing on the slide, and now you will be taking out the specimen on the slide and you are going to keep them inside the Coplin jar. You can see this is the Coplin jar, plastic Coplin jar, it can be glass also, right? And this is the lid of the Coplin jar, this is the Coplin jar, and now you can see these are the slots for the slide, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So total 5 slides we can keep in the Coplin jar. What is the advantage of the Coplin jar? Coplin jar will be used for staining and processing both things. See, it will fix the slides, then we can stain also, and then we can dry them also without removing from the jar. Remember, you don't need to take out the slide from the jar for the fixation and staining. So fixation and staining both can be done within the jar itself on the slide. That is the advantage of the Coplin slide staining jar. That is why we are calling Coplin slide staining jar. So we can stain also, we can fix them also, right? Without removing from the jar. Now I'm going to tell you two important basic, very basic thing about the FNAC. FNB fine needle biopsy with aspiration, without aspiration. There are two techniques. See, this is with aspiration and another technique which I'm going to tell you without aspiration. Right, so what are the differences? Difference is just syringe is having plunger along with them. So when you are having syringe and plunger along with the needle, they are for aspiration, with aspiration, whereas without aspiration you are going to use only needle without any syringe. Right, now you can see only needles are there, not syringes. There is no syringe or no plunger, right? So that is the basic difference. So now we will see what are the steps in the FNB with aspiration. So fine needle aspiration with aspiration, number one step, you can see this is the needle which is going into the mass, right? So needle is going into the mass, and now you can see this is the syringe, right? This is the syringe. So what is the next step? Next step, we are going to pull up the plunger. So now you can see this plunger has been pulled up, right? Plunger has been pulled up. So we have taken out the plunger back. So what will happen? There will be creation of the negative pressure. So now you can see there is a negative pressure has been built inside the syringe, right? So this negative pressure will be taking out the tissue into the needle, and they will be present in the hub of the needle, right? So now you can see the cell will be present inside the needle because of this negative pressure, right? And now you are going to move this. Now you are going to move this up and down or back and forth so that they can take out the sample from here also, from here also, from here also. That is why we have to need the movement, right? And after that, what we are going to do, negative pressure will be released. So now you can see negative pressure has been released, right? So negative pressure has been released. Negative pressure has been released. So now you can see how we are doing. First, we are introducing the needle into the mass. Then we are going to create the negative pressure. Then moving them up and down. Then taking out the negative pressure. And now you are taking out the needle from the mass. So now you can see needle is taken out from the mass. So mass is here, needle has been taken. Now you separate the needle and separate the syringe. And after separating the syringe, again you are pulling up the plunger. So plunger is pulled out again. So you are seeing there is a pulled plunger. So why this plunger has been pulled? So that there can be creation of some air into the syringe, right? So that this air, now this air will be useful at this step. Now you can see at this step what we are going to do. Now you can see that syringe and needle has been attached to each other. And when you are moving the plunger down, so what is happening, that air pressure which has been created inside this needle is now pushing the cells onto the slide, right? So now I understand. So this air which has been created here, you can see here the air which has been created here. Now this air is pushing the cell onto the slide. So now you can see sample is blown onto the microscopic slide. So this is called FNB with aspiration. So you are aspirating with the help of negative pressure. You are aspirating with the help of negative pressure. And then you are taking out the air into the syringe and then pushing them by air, by air you are pushing the cells from the needle hub onto the slide. That is called as FNB, fine needle biopsy with aspiration. This is the number one technique. Second technique of the FNAC is FNB without aspiration. See, in this what we are doing, in this we are just using needle without any syringes, right? So you are poking needle into the mass, right? You are inserting the needle into the mass. And now see, because cells, abnormal cells can be at any location, here also, here also, here also. So you have to make them at various angles, right? Various angles. So needles are moved back and forth, varying the angle, so that they can take out all the necessary cell for examination, all the necessary abnormal cell for the examination, right? So that is why we are varying our angle for tissue, right? So this is the first thing. First you put the needle, then vary the angle, take out, and then you take out the needle from here. After taking out the needle, see, there will be some cells here. So now how we will take out the cells onto the slide? Now we are adding this syringe, as we have seen in the FNB with aspiration, and we will be creating air here. This air will be pushing the cells onto the slide. So now you can see cells are present here. So needle is attached to the syringe, sample is blown onto the microscopic slide. So that is the FNB without aspiration. So now you can see in FNB without aspiration, you are using only needle, varying the angle, take out the needle, attach with the syringe, blow out all the material from the needle hub with the help of air, and now you go for cytological study. So what is the use of without aspiration? Without aspiration is actually used for vascular lesion or for thyroid lesion, so that they can reduce the bleeding or minimize the bleeding. So it is for thyroid and vascular lesion, right? So remember that. FNB without aspiration is for vascular lesion and thyroid lesion to minimize the bleeding. Examiner can ask you this question, right? On these lesions, to minimize the bleeding, we are using only needle, not using any syringe while doing the FNAC, right? While doing the FNAC, right? Or fine needle biopsy, right? So done. Moving on to the next. What fixation? Why we require fixation for these cytological cells or any kind of pathological cells or tissue? To preserve the architecture of the cell. So here also fixation is required to preserve the cytomorphology of the cell. So morphology, cells should be having exact shape and size what they actually exist in our body, right? That is why we require fixation, right? Otherwise, if they are smaller or if they are larger and there is artifact, then it will be difficult to have a proper interpretation of the cytology. So for that purpose, we require fixator, right? So there are two methods of the fixation. One, when we are taking out the sample, right? When we are taking out the sample on this slide, we will be just keeping them in the air and we are drying with the help of air only. That is called as air drying method of fixation. Second, after taking out the sample on this slide, we are going to dip them into the alcohol solution. That is called as alcohol fixed, because alcohol is wet, so that is why it is also called as wet fixed smear. So there are two types of fixation: air drying fixation and alcohol fixed fixation. See, these two fixation will decide what kind of stain we are going to use. That is very, very important. In cytology, air drying, when you are using air drying, you are going to use the Roman-Nowosky stain, which has following family members: GIMSA, May Grunewald, GIMSA stain, Leishmann or Wright stain. And second is the alcohol fixed. When we are using alcohol fixation, remember, for alcohol fixation, we are going to use Papanicolaou stain and hematoxylin and eosin stain. So hematoxylin and eosin stain and Papanicolaou is used for alcohol. So now you understand what I am saying, what kind of staining we are going to use in cytology. That will be dependent on the method of fixation: air-dried Roman-Nowosky stain, alcohol-fixed Papanicolaou and hematoxylin and eosin stain, right? So what fixative is ideal? See, when examiner asks you in your viva exam, ideal fixative kya hai? What is ideal fixative? So remember, equal parts of the ether and 95% of ethanol. So ether and ethanol, both in equal part, will be the ideal fixative for this slide. And what is the most commonly used fixative? So now you can see there are two different questions. Ideal fixative, ideal means, see, ideal does not exist in our practical life, because why ether is not existing in our practical life? We are using only 95% ethanol. So why we are using only 95% ethanol alone? Because ether is flammable. Aag pakad lega, right? It will catch fire. That is why we are not using ether. So most commonly used fixative in cytology lab is the 95% of the ethanol. And what will be the timing? Means by what time cells will be fixed upon these cells? So this will take only 10 to 15 minutes at room temperature. So now you understand, 95% of ethanol you are taking, into 95% of ethanol you are dipping the slide. Within 10 to 15 minutes at room temperature, it will be fixed. And where you have taken them up? The slide was inside the Coplin jar. So this will be used for the staining and fixation. Coplin jar is used for staining and fixation. And this will be used for the smear transport also, if you have to transport to some distant part, right? Now, when you are talking about the cytology stain, I already have told you, depending on the method of fixation, right? Papanicolaou and hematoxylin is for alcohol fixed. Roman-Nowosky is for air dried, right? So now I understand. So Papanicolaou, hematoxylin, Roman-Nowosky, these are the three basic or main stains which we are using on the cytological preparations. And out of these three, which is the best one? Best one for routine cytology is Papanicolaou stain. Remember, examiner will be asking all these questions. Which is the best cytology stain? Papanicolaou stain is the best for the routine cytology, right? So what is Papanicolaou stain contains? What are the constituent of the Papanicolaou stain? Because this kind of question came in the previous year June AIIMS exam, so examiner can ask this question. And it's quite a common question in the MD viva also. Three solutions are used. One is the nuclear solution. So remember, in Papanicolaou, three solutions are used. One is nuclear and two are cytoplasmic counter stain. So what is the nuclear stain? Nuclear is Harris hematoxylin. Remember, nuclear stain will be Harris hematoxylin. And there are two cytoplasmic counter stain we are using. So cytoplasmic counter stain is orange G, which is called OG6, or eosin alcohol, which is called as EA65 or EA50. So remember, EA65 or EA50 eosin alcohol. So cytoplasmic is orange G and eosin alcohol. And nuclear is Harris hematoxylin for Papanicolaou stain, which is the most commonly used stain for cytological preparation. See, on Pap staining, this is also called as Pap. In short, I will be calling them Pap. Pap is a polychromatic stain. Now you can see polychromatic, multiple colors are there: green, blue, right, and orange or red color appearance will be there, right? So you can see the hue is also there. So that is why it is called as polychromatic. Papanicolaou is polychromatic. They are using multiple dyes and different differential staining of the cells. So what will be the result you are going to see on Pap stain? You can see nuclei is blue or black. So you can see these are the nuclei. How is the nuclei? Is blue or black? So nuclei is looking blue or black. Cytoplasm, See, cytoplasm of non-keratinizing squamous cells are blue or green. These are non-keratinizing, right? So now you can see what I'm saying, that when you are seeing non-keratinizing, right? So when we are seeing non-keratinizing cells, their cytoplasm is green or blue in appearance, right? But remember, if you are seeing keratinizing cells, they will be pink or orange. So this one is the keratinizing, right? So keratinizing cells are pink or orange. So that is the simple interpretation of the result of the Papanicolaou stain in the cytological examination. So non-keratinizing is green or blue, and keratinizing is pink or orange, right? That is the pap staining. Now coming to the next one, is the next one is the hematoxylin and eosin stain. Hematoxylin and eosin stain, they also have nuclear and cytoplasmic. So nuclear stain is Harris hematoxylin, cytoplasmic is eosin stain. Simple, right? So hematoxylin and eosin stain, you can see nuclear stain is Harris hematoxylin, cytoplasmic is eosin stain. And when you are going to stain on hematoxylin and eosin stain, you can see hematoxylin will stain the nuclei in the blue color. So you can see all these are nuclei which are blue in color, right? Nuclei is basophilic or blue in color, and eosin will stain extracellular and cytoplasm area into the pink color. So you can see extracellular and cytoplasm both are pink color. Extracellular and cytoplasm both are pink color because of the eosin, right? So that is the hematoxylin and eosin stain, right? Romanowski stain, as already I have told you, it is used for air-dried, right? Air-dried cytology slides, right? So there are four members: Lishman, May Grunwald, Jimsa, Jenner, and Wright stain, right? By default, I said Jimsa stain twice in earlier discussion. So just remember that was actually Lishman stain, then May Grunwald, Jimsa is also called as Jimsa stain. Jenner stain, Wright stain, right? So here most commonly used is the May Grunwald Jimsa stain. So Jimsa stain is most commonly used in the Romanowski stain for the cytological preparation. So what will be the appearance on the Romanowski stain, right? So as I have told you, air dried specimen, and remember it is superior to the pap staining for cytoplasmic study. Remember, this is very, very important. May Grunwald Jimsa is for cytoplasmic study. Cytoplasmic study will be better than the pap staining. But remember, when you have to study the nuclear staining, for nuclear staining, pap staining is superior. So try to understand like this. When you want to study the cytoplasm, right? So for cytoplasm, Jimsa is better than pap, right? And when you want to study the nucleus, for nuclear staining, remember, pap is superior to the Jimsa stain. So these are the two very basics which examiner ask in exam, right? If you want to study, or cytoplasmic study will be best done by which of the following stain? Cytological stain, Jimsa stain. Nuclear is best studied by which of the following stain? Pap stain, right? So here you can see nuclei will be blue color, cytoplasm will be pink or rose color, bacteria, if you find bacteria, they will be also blue in color, right? Now, how you will decide that specimen is adequate? So this is also called as TBT, the Bethesda system, TBS, right? So the Bethesda system says that specimen is adequate when it contains well preserved two things, squamous cells and endocervical cells, right? So well preserved squamous cells and endocervical cells, when they are present, then a specimen will be told that it is a adequate specimen. And what should be the minimum number of the squamous cells? Remember, this is very, very important question. Minimum number of a squamous cell for adequacy. So it differs. If you are using conventional cytology, 8,000 to 12,000 cells are adequate. But when you are going for the liquid based cytology, then 5,000 cells will be adequate for the smear examination. So now I understand. So minimum number of squamous cell for adequacy for conventional smear is 8,000 to 12,000. And for liquid based cytology, it should be 5,000 cells, right? Now, when you are going to see the pap smear, what are the areas you are going to see in an epithelium? See, Now you can see there are four important layer from where you are going to expect different kind of cells. So when you are seeing the uppermost, outermost layer, you can see of the skin, superficial cells, right? So superficial cell, you are going to see these are the superficial squamous cell, right? Superficial squamous cell, which are looking, keratin wala, so it is looking orangeophilic. Now intermediate is looking a little basophilic, parabasal is again basophilic, and basal is also basophilic. So what is the difference? If you observe, this cell is bigger, then they're getting smaller, and nuclear size is, you can see the basal cell is having largest or biggest nuclei. Then parabasal is having little bit smaller, and less smaller will be intermediate, and the smallest will be present in the superficial cells. So one by one, I'm going to tell you about these cells. When you are going to see superficial squamous cells, they are already, I've told you, from the outermost epithelium. So they are eosinophilic. Can you see? They are pinkish eosinophilic polygonal cell. Polygonal cell. Cytoplasm is eosinophilic, right? And there is a very small, shrunk nuclei, pycnotic nuclei. So polygonal cell, eosinophilic cytoplasm, shrunk pycnotic nuclei will be there. So when you are going to expect this kind of superficial cells, so that is again a very, very important thing to understand. So when you are going to expect, whenever there is a more estrogen in the patient, right? So hyperestrogenemia, right? Whenever there is a more estrogen, there will be more superficial squamous cell, right? So there will be more superficial squamous cells. So where we can see this in the late proliferative stage and ovulatory period of the menstrual cycle, right? So late proliferative stage and ovulatory phase of the menstrual cycle will be having this kind of superficial squamous cell where estrogen level is very high. So remember, this will be superficial squamous cell will be having more estrogen, right? Now moving on to the next one. If you see the second type of slide, in this you can again see the polygonal cell, but nucleus is little bigger and they are having vesicular chromatin, right? So vesicular or dispersed granular chromatin, right? So here you can, if you look at the cytoplasm, they are basophilic cytoplasm, and nucleus is vesicular dispersed granular chromatin, right? So now you can see there is a very thin or transparent basophilic. We can also call this as a thin transparent basophilic cytoplasm, right? So thin transparent basophilic cytoplasm is present here, right? Pycnotic nuclei, but here nuclei is not pycnotic. We will say that they are having dispersed vesicular nuclear chromatin. So under what condition it will be present? So remember, superficial squamous cell was present with the estrogen, and intermediate, these are the intermediate squamous cell. Intermediate squamous cells are present whenever there is a high progesterone level, right? Whenever there is a high progesterone level, you are going to expect. So high progesterone, when you can expect? Into the second and third trimester of the pregnancy, right? So second or third trimester of the pregnancy, you can expect this intermediate cells will be more in number, right? Now, third type of cell is the parabasal squamous cells. So parabasal squamous cells are from the basal layer. They are the smallest epithelial cell. Now you can see they are round oval cell. Round oval cell, right? Round oval cell with dense homogeneous basophilic cytoplasm. Now you can see here it was, see, intermediate was having transparent and thin, right? Transparent and thin basophilic. But what here it is dense basophilic, right? So here cytoplasm is dense basophilic cytoplasm, right? And nucleus is same like that, right? Like, so the only difference you can notice is the dense basophilic cytoplasm will be seen in the parabasal squamous cells. So where you are going to see this parabasal squamous cells are more, so this will be seen in the postmenopausal lady. Postmenopausal lady, or the lady which is having less amount of estrogen, right? So see, when estrogen was high, now you can recall this, what we are seeing, when high level of estrogen, you are seeing the superficial squamous cell, right? High level of progesterone, you are seeing the intermediate squamous cell, एंड नो एस्ट्रोजन. रिमेंबर पोस्ट मीनोपॉजल विदाउट एस्ट्रोजन यू आर गोइंग टू सी द पैराबेसल स्क्वामस सेल, राइट. द लास्ट टाइप इज द स्मॉलर वन, राइट. यू कैन सी अगेन राउंड एंड पॉलीगोनल सेल्स विद डेंस बेसोफिलिक साइटोप्लाज्म, राइट. एंड हियर यू कैन सी राउंड सेंट्रली लोकेटेड न्यूक्लियाई, राइट. सो दीज आर फ्रॉम द बेसल लेयर अगेन एंड दीज आर प्रोटेक्टिव रिस्पॉन्स टू द स्टिमुलाई एंड दिस विल क्रिएट द ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन जोन. So basal cell are also known as squamous metaplastic cells. They are going to form the transformation, right? These are metabolically active. So remember, metabolically active cells and maximum abnormality will be seen in this area, right? So that is the importance of the squamous metaplastic cell or the basal cell. Maximum deformity will be happening at this area only. Right, so these are the basic introduction about the cytology. Now you can see all cells together. These are the superficial squamous cell. You can see these are the superficial squamous cell, right? Then you can see the intermediate squamous cell, thin transparent basophilic cytoplasm. Then you can notice the third one is the parabasal cell. Parabasal cell, you can see there is a dense basophilic cytoplasm. And little more smaller cell and dense cytoplasm will be seen in the basal cell, which is also called as squamous metaplastic cell. So these are the basic introduction. Next time I am going to discuss about the pathologies of the infections and tumors in cytopathology. So thank you so much to all of you. And if you want to subscribe my app, you can subscribe my app from the dpma.co.in. And if you want to subscribe my book or take my books and notes, you can come to the publication, that is the devanshpublication.com, and you can associate it with me by subscribing and my YouTube channel and share with your maximum friends so that they can also get benefit of this basic introduction of the cytopathology, which will be extremely helpful for those who are pursuing MD also and those who are going to appear for INICT or NEET PG or FMG exam. So thank you so much to all of you for listening this, and my best wishes for your exams.